Please enjoy hundreds of my video lectures on telecom and wireless. Please do not forget to subscribe to my channel. Please also like my videos. Please share my channel with your friends and colleagues. Thank you.
In this chapter, we'll look at power control in CDMA 2000 systems. Specifically, we'll look at how does power control work in CDMA 2000, why power control first of all, and what are the power control structures that are available, the various types of power control, and in the reverse link, open loop power control and closed loop power control, and in the forward link, open loop power control and closed loop power control, and the summary of all these power control systems, and also the various factors that affect power control's performance. Let's move on to power control in CDMA 2000 in detail. Of a typical CDMA power control. First of all, why power control? Look at the figure and the various texts that appear on your screen now. Power control refers to the strategies or techniques required in order to adjust, correct and manage the power from the mobile station to the base station in both directions, both uplink and downlink, in a very efficient manner. This is power control. CDMA, as we all know, is an interference limited system. All the mobiles transmit in the same frequency. Therefore, internal interference is generated among the people who are having their mobiles active. And this interference actually plays a very critical role in determining the system capacity and the voice quality. More mobiles active means more interference and voice quality deteriorates. Therefore, any CDMA system is limited by the interference, which directly is proportional to the number of people active. That means system capacity is limited by the interference that is generated. Okay. If all the mobiles transmit at the same power levels, then the strong interfering signal from a mobile which is very close to the base station may mask out a weak desired signal from a mobile which is far away from the base station. A desired signal from a far-off mobile is totally masked by an unwanted mobile which is close to the base station. This is called near-far problem, and we'll see more about this in the next few slides. The next aspect is, due to non-coherent detection at the base station, interference on the reverse link is more critical than the interference in the forward link. Therefore, the reverse link power control is much more essential in a CDMA system. Okay, let us recall CDMA in a nutshell. CDMA is an interference limited system based on the number of users. CDMA has got a upper capacity limit which is called soft capacity. Since all users use the same frequency, each user is a potential noise source to the others. The noise contributed by all users adds up cumulatively, and this will restrict how many users can use this system with an acceptable quality or acceptable signal to noise ratio. Precise power control, therefore, is very critical in CDMA communications. Now let us look at the new text box that is appearing on the screen. Now, why power control? Power control is needed to counter near and far end interference and fading. Near and far end is also known as 1 by r power 4 attenuation. Now, what is near and far end problem? Refer to this figure. For example, if user A is 1 km away from the base station and user B is 4 km away from the base station, the power received at the base station from user A is 4 power 4, that is equal to 256 times or 24 dB stronger than that of the signal received from user B. As a consequence, user B's communication will be swamped or totally masked by user A, and user B will be suffering in communication quality. In other words, mobile stations which transmit excessive power increase interference level to other weaker mobiles in the network. This is near and far end problem. This follows 1 by r power 4 law. What are the objectives of power control therefore? There are two major objectives. The goal is to keep each mobile station at the absolute minimum power level necessary, neither more nor less, to ensure acceptable service quality in the entire network. The second goal is the power received at the base station from each mobile, irrespective of where it is in the network, should be the same level. Why is it required? If the signals received from various mobiles in the network are received at the base station at the same level, obviously there is a minimization of signal to interference ratio. These are the two specific goals of power control mechanism. Let us look at the new visuals that are on your screen now. For example, if any rogue mobile transmits at such a high power, then another mobile nearby gets flooded with this rogue's noise, like a violin getting violent in a symphony, and the symphony is totally lost. Now what happens? All efforts of recovering respective signals may become futile. Therefore, a sort of power democracy is the objective, where every mobile gets a chance to achieve uniform signal-to-noise ratio. That is, the mobiles transmit at just adequate power, neither more nor less. Let us look at the benefits of the power control. To maximize system capacity and ensure uniform communication quality, each mobile should go through a rigorous power control process. We have seen this just now. Power control also increases battery life of the mobile and increases the talk time. Lower power levels in the network reduces co-channel interference. Lower power reduces health hazards. Counters fading very effectively. These are the benefits of power control. Now what is fading? The received signal also undergoes rapid fading due to multipath, fluctuations, propagation loss, etc. And we have also seen there is a short-term fading called Rayleigh fading and a long-term fading called propagation fading. Now, how rigorous is this power control in CDMA? It's quite rigorous. In order to maintain the strength of the received signal at the base station uniform, a rigorous power control is very much necessary. Power update is done in the mobile based on specific instructions from the BSC and BTS every 1.25 milliseconds. Wow! That is 800 times every second, the base station constantly instructs the mobile either to increase its power by a fraction or decrease it by a fraction. Frame error rate is a yardstick used to assess overall quality and therefore power levels of the mobile. Having understood the need for power control, let us look at the power control structures that are available in CDMA. Let us look at a few terminologies. Closed loop versus open loop. Open loop refers to when a transmitter makes power adjustments without explicit feedback from its own receiver. That is, transmitter makes unilateral decisions. On the other hand, closed loop refers to when a transmitter makes its power adjustments based on specific feedback from its receiver. In other words, a receiver estimates the power of a received signal and tells the transmitter how to adjust its power. Example, base station transmitter may make power adjustments based on the power received at its base station receive terminal, which in turn obviously is a signal transmitted by the mobile. Okay, this is about open loop and closed loop. Let us look at another set of terminologies, inner loop versus outer loop. These loops are analogous to nested loops in a programming context. We are all familiar with programming. The inner loops are executed many times, each time an outer loop is executed. That is, for one parameter update in an outer loop, an inner loop may be executed 50 times. Okay, so this is about inner loop and outer loop. Two more variants are possible, that is forward channel inner loop and forward channel outer loop, reverse channel inner loop and reverse channel outer loop. Let's look at a few of them. In the previous slide, we saw the various types of power controls briefly. Let us look at them in detail now. First one is open loop power control. When a mobile first attempts to access the base station, it uses open loop power control. It needs to compromise between interference caused to the system by other users and the access time. Now look at the dilemma. Interference caused to the other users is directly proportional to the mobile's transmit power, while the probability of the network access for a given attempt is also directly proportional to the transmit power. So, if the transmit power is quite high, the access time gets considerably reduced, but interference increases. If the mobile's power is too low, the interference cost is less, but the access time becomes longer. There is a dilemma out here. In the open loop power control, the mobile measures the received pilot strength, which is directly proportional to path loss. First, it makes an estimate of what it is receiving. The transmit power then is adjusted and set inversely to the measured pilot strength. If the pilot that has been received is weak, the transmit power of the mobile is increased. It's a bit weird. That is, you can see very often people making telephone conversations, when they receive a signal from someone which is low, they tend to start shouting, which is totally unnecessary. Because what is received belongs to downlink and what you are transmitting belongs to uplink. But that's the way the open loop power control works. I receive a weak signal, therefore I am going to increase my transmit power. Weak pilot means large path loss and therefore high mobile transmit power. Strong pilot means low path loss and therefore low mobile transmit power. So open loop power control counters propagation loss and shadowing very swiftly. Open loop control action is continuous throughout a call. Let's look at closed loop power control. What does it mean? Closed loop refers to when, for example, a mobile makes its power adjustments based on a specific feedback received from the base. The base receives a signal from the mobile, makes an estimate of the path loss, and through the base station transmitter advises back to the mobile to adjust, either increase or decrease its transmit power. So this is based on a specific feedback from the base station, unlike open loop power control. And there are two variations, slow power control, typically 50 cycles or slower. Slow power control is based on feedback of frame error rate performance. If the frame error rates are quite low at the base station controller, that means the signal quality is excellent, therefore the mobile is asked to reduce its power. And vice versa, if the frame rate is very poor, that means signal quality is bad and therefore mobile should increase its transmit power. This is how slow power control works. The transmitter keeps adjusting its power levels in order to keep frame error rate at a desired level. This adapts to large scale propagation effects, helps to maintain performance target level. This loop is very slow, 50 cycles. The fastest it can feedback information is once per every frame, that is frame error indication. Let us look at another variant, that is fast loop power control. This happens quite fast at 800 cycles or even faster. So how does it work? The mobile receiver, for example, measures EB by I0 and compares that to a predetermined threshold. If the measured value is less than the threshold, transmit power is increased. And if the measured value is greater than the threshold, the transmit power will be decreased. So this is often called the inner loop. Please note that the receiver threshold is not one single constant value, but it is quite dynamic. Receiver threshold is dynamically communicated to the mobile by the base station on a specific control channel. Example, GSM uses closed loop with 8 power classes in the base station and 5 power classes in the mobile station. Let us look at inner loop versus outer loop. These loops, as we said earlier, are analogous to nested loops in programming context. The inner loops are executed many times. Each time an outer loop is executed. There are again two parts to fast closed loop power control. One is inner loop control and the other one is outer loop control. So what is inner loop control? These are generally fast loops. The inner loop control works on smaller time scale, that is 1.25 milliseconds. And instructs the transmitter to change its transmit power in order to equalize the received power. What is outer loop? This is generally a slow loop. The outer loop works on a slightly longer time scale, 20 milliseconds, and adjusts the inner loop target in order to achieve a performance specification. Please note, Autoloop is directly not involved in the business of issuing commands to increase or decrease the power. Instead, it works on adjusting the inner loop's target value only.
Hi guys, hope you have enjoyed this video. Before you leave this, please ensure that you are subscribing to this. Also, please do like these videos and share it amongst your friends and colleagues. There are plenty of other videos and I hope you will be able to find time to browse through all these things. Thank you.